What's up? Good morning, everybody, and welcome, and thank you for tuning in to our Women in STEM panel discussion today as part of Science Week, all with thanks to Science Foundation Ireland, all as part of the STEM and Sustainability Project run by ourselves at the Rediscovery Centre in conjunction with Science Foundation Ireland. We have a really, really fun and interesting hour in store for you. We are here to inform and to inspire the next generation of women in STEM through stories, questions, and a cool video or two along the way. Demand for STEM professionals is expected to grow by about 8% between now and the year 2025. There are currently already about 118,000 people in Ireland working in STEM-related careers. But unfortunately, only 25% of these roles are currently performed by women. We hope that by the end of today, you, our audience, will have a better idea of what the day-to-day jobs of our panelists entail. And hopefully, they will even steer some of you watching into pursuing an area of STEM which is of interest to you. My name is Ali Knight. I'm the Lead Education Officer here at the Rediscovery Centre. And I will be your host and MC for the evening. So, or the morning even, don't even know what time of day it is. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about a day in my life, but as you can hear, it's Science Week. My voice is pretty much already gone. So we're actually gonna let past Ali tell you a little bit about what a day in my life might look like. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the video. What's up, everybody? My name is Ali Knight, and I am the Lead Education Officer here at the Rediscovery Centre, and welcome along to a day in my life as part of our Women in STEM event. So follow along with me and I'll tell you a little bit about what it is that I do. So my job primarily involves going around to schools all across the country and having students visit us here at the Rediscovery Centre, where we run lots of hands-on experiential workshops teaching students all about the wonderful world of STEM, as well as teaching them a little bit about sustainability and the circular economy along the way. So how did I get here, you may ask? Well, I have an undergrad degree in zoology from UCD, and I have a master's degree in animal behavior and welfare from Queen's University Belfast. So come on in and I'll show you exactly where it is that I work. So one of the most amazing things about my job here at the Rediscovery Centre is that I get to go around and work with some amazing students from all across the country who teach me as much as I actually teach them. So one of the projects we worked on recently was with our good friends over at Trinity Comprehensive, who built us this amazing bottle cap mural, really emphasizing that you can be a little bit creative with the thing you normally see as being waste. And that's what we like to do in our workshops. It's all about being a little bit creative and thinking outside the box. So you, for example, might see a milk carton, but I see a wallet or even a bird feeder. No, look, Cash, that was good, wasn't it? You might see a dusty old t-shirt that you're never gonna wear again. But here at the Rediscovery Centre, we see a lovely jazzy tote bag. You yourself might see an old kitchen roll tube that you're just gonna throw in the bin, but not here at the Rediscovery Centre. We like to teach students to be creative, use their imaginations, and even create a rocket that can be blasted off into outer space. I really, really love my job here at the Rediscovery Centre because I get to share my love and my passion for STEM with students all across the country who will hopefully be inspired to get into careers like the amazing ones that we are hearing about today. So that's a little bit about a day in my life. Thank you very, very much for joining.
The bloopers of that video are something to behold. There was a lot of walking in. It's really, really tough is one thing that I learned. But today we are here to answer your questions. So we have some students lined up to come onto the screen and ask their questions. And for everyone else watching live on YouTube, please put your questions, put your comments, put your favorite science facts, jokes, whatever it happens to be, pop them into the live chat. And we'll get through as many of them as we can once I've introduced all of our speakers. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Dr. Eilish McLoughlin to the show. So Dr. Eilish McLoughlin is an associate professor and the head of the School of Physical Sciences at Dublin City University. Eilish is a global leader in physics education and has extensive experience in leading physics and STEM education programs.
Her research interests are in the use of inquiry approaches to physics learning and teaching in all levels of education in Ireland. Eilish, you're very, very welcome on board. How are you today?
Ali, I'm kind of worn out looking at how you were so innovative there and moving around and show us things. So you're balancing your life skills were well displayed. I'm good. I'm here in the School of Physics office here in DCU. I did a degree in physics and a PhD then in nanotechnology. And now I'm head of school. And as I came up as a physics student in school, I had a physics teacher, and I was lucky to have a physics teacher and have the option in an all-girls school in Mayo to have a physics teacher and a physics class. That's not the case in all-girls schools around the country, firstly. And also, can I say that we only have about 20% of the teachers that teach junior cycle science are physics specialists. So one in 20 students are lucky if they get taught science, physics, chemistry, biology, a junior cycle by a physics teacher. So I've been running a program for the last 2-3 years where we put the teachers back to school and they're doing this upskilling program. So in the majority, they're biology, chemistry, mathematics teachers, and they're getting an extra qualification now to be qualified to teach physics. If they're qualified, passionate, expert in teaching physics, that can only be good for the students of Ireland.
Yeah, I agree. So it's one thing now, physics, I'm a zoologist by background. That's what I studied in college. And I'm not gonna lie, I was a bit scared of physics in school. And even going through college, I tried to avoid physics as much as I possibly could. So is physics really as hard and as scary as it's made out to be?
Well, I do physics because I find it easy for me. It's not easy for everybody. And also you benefit from having a really, really good and interested and passionate teacher. Teachers, parents, society were the big influencers of how we perceive physics and maths and other subjects. Let me ask you, Ali, do you ever learn a musical instrument? Can you play the violin?
You're giving me far too much credit. The most I could master.
Why can't you play the violin?
Why can't I? Because I haven't practiced.
Never tried. You need to practice. You need to be interested in it. And physics is just like that. Physics is fundamental to understanding the world around us. And if we have an interest in trying to solve the big global challenges like water, waste, energy, climate change, just the small little problems, then we need to have physics. Yeah, physics to do that. And the only way to get good at physics is to do it. Practice it. You know, learn from good people. Work on interesting things. So then it becomes not difficult, but it's that. So you cannot say it's not for me, it's too hard. Well, can you play a musical instrument? What helps you to get good at a musical instrument? You develop your talent through practice, experience, and giving it time.
Absolutely. Perfect. Aileen, thank you very, very much. We'll check back in with you later on. I'd like to now introduce our second panelist, who is Dr. Aileen Doran. So Dr. Aileen Doran is a postdoctoral researcher in UCD and iCRAG, and works in geology and geochemistry. Part of her PhD research included the studying of zinc and lead, which are very, very important materials in our everyday lives through their use in vehicles and in some batteries as well. Aileen is currently researching copper cobalt deposits in the Zambian copper belt. Aileen is currently the co-director of the EDI in Geosciences project that acts as a platform for all of us to come together to make geoscience more accessible and more inclusive as well. And fun fact about Aileen, she recently won the SFI Research Image of the Year Award in 2021. This research image competition celebrates images that have been captured by SFI-funded researchers during the course of their research. Aileen, you're very, very welcome on the panel. Lovely to have you.
Hello, everyone. It's really nice to be here as well. And thank you, Ali, for the introduction.
No problem at all. Aileen, so can we talk about this image, first of all? Because again, I was looking at, I think if to me, it seemed like one of those ink blot tests where when you looked at it, you could see whatever you wanted to see in it and maybe told you something about your personality. And we might bring it up here, Aileen, for everyone to have a look. And maybe you can give us a little idea of what you actually captured.
Yeah, actually, I like your version of the ink blot test, because the other ones I've heard is that it kind of looks like Celtic knot symbols, or so I kind of like that. So Yeah, I think that's probably why it won anything. So yeah, this is a microscope image. So it was taken from a little thin sliver of rock that we put under a light microscope to see what minerals were there. And so the mineral we're looking at here is what's called sphalerite. So as Ali mentioned, this is a big source of the metal zinc. So zinc is actually a really cool metal in a lot of ways, because it's really important for a lot of the technologies, but it's also really important to a lot of green technologies and things like electric vehicles and certain types of batteries. And also this specific image is from a mine that was closed in 2015, but it was Ireland's second biggest base metal deposit down in Tipperary, Lachine. And so that was where a big part of my PhD work was on. And that also was really cool, I think, for Ireland, because we're actually one of the biggest suppliers of zinc in all of Europe. And it's actually a lot cleaner is the way we kind of think about it. So it has less of these like unwanted elements, like things like arsenic. So it's a little bit more environmentally friendly in terms of energy that's required for processing it. So Ireland's in a really good position to be a big leader in zinc supply, I think.
Good to know. Yeah, it's nice to hear that, you know, we're number one in something, or we're getting a gold medal in something, you know. Brilliant. So like, I love those kind of microscopy images. I think they're really, really fascinating. Any of those small world photograph competitions that happen, they're just stunning. And we often are very, you know, captivated by the beauty of nature around us, but the teeny tiny things need to be appreciated as well. So geology, is that what you always wanted to do from when you were a tiny little tot?
That's a really good question. And the answer is no. I did not know what I wanted to do, or I did not know what I wanted to do with my life. But to be honest, I didn't even know what geology was before accidentally ending up in a course in university studying geology. So in terms of my own background, I come from Wexford. That's the most important part here. And I went to a Desh secondary school. So in my school, we didn't actually have like chemistry or anything like that for leaving cert level. And so now doing geochemistry, it was a bit of a learning curve, but it's quite interesting in terms of you don't really need to like have that strong background to do things like geochemistry and stuff. But in terms of, I guess, how I ended up in geology, I was completely planning on doing just about everything else. I wanted to be a medical doctor. I wanted to be an astronaut at one point. I wanted to be a teacher. And the one I settled on up to my leaving CEO was psychology. So I had every intention of going to university, do psychology. And then a couple of weeks before the CEA deadline, my geography teacher started talking about volcanoes and about how what you get taught at secondary school isn't the full story. When you go to university, you learn a bit more. Just really caught my attention. So I Googled earth sciences and put the first course I found down. And that was down in UCC in Cork. And so it was a really great course, actually, because it starts off quite broad in the first year is like earth sciences with biology and zoology and ecology, plant sciences, and geology is a big part of it. Then you specialize in second year. So yeah, it's basically been a series of notions to get to where I am, but I'm really glad that I am where I am.
Yeah, I can really identify with that. I mean, up until junior cert, I was dead set on being an accountant. So completely different to where I am now. So really important for all of the students who are listening, you know, you will chop and change your mind a million and one times. And, you know, even if you do start a course somewhere, there's always the opportunity to change as well, which is really, really important. Yeah, exactly. Aileen, thank you very much. We will pop back to you. And at this point, I'd like to remind everyone watching that if you have any of our incredibly inspiring panelists, please do just make sure to pop them in the chat or even just say hello and let us know where you're tuning in from. So without further ado then, I'd like to introduce our third panelist, which is Professor Anna Davis. Anna Davis is a professor of geography, environment and society at Trinity College Dublin, where she directs the Environmental Governance Research Group. Anna is widely published in the fields of environmental decision making and sustainable development, and she advises government through her membership of Ireland's National Climate Change Advisory Council. Anna, you're very, very welcome on board.
Hi, Ali, welcome. Thanks for everything. That's a really nice introduction.
No worries at all. So, Anna, do you want to tell us maybe about some of the projects or the most exciting projects that you're working on at the moment in your field?
Yeah, thanks. Well, I mean, the life of a scientist is really diverse. So I'm doing multiple things at the moment. I'll just tell you briefly about some of those things. Like, we've got work going on creating an all-island climate and biodiversity research network to address the joint climate and biodiversity crisis with all sorts of subjects, not just STEM subjects, but also with arts and humanities. Just launching a climate smart platform for TY students and teachers to learn about climate change adaptation and to play a serious game called iCRAG. If you're interested in finding out more about that, just look at the climatesmart.ie website and do get in touch. But I suppose my main piece of work at the moment is to understand the sustainability impacts of urban food sharing. And I'm just about to start a new four-year project with European colleagues called Cultivate to understand the contributions that these kinds of activities in areas around us are making to our everyday lives.
Oh, amazing. Yeah. So, and I think we actually have a video to show that you put together to talk about those kind of food sharing networks. So we might just kind of let the video speak for itself a little bit, give you a little bit of a rest, and we'll take a look at the video.
My name is Anna Davis, and I'm the principal investigator of Share City and professor of geography, environment, society at Trinity College Dublin in Ireland. So I've been working on matters of sustainable consumption now for more than a decade. And it's very clear that we have an unsustainable food system. The Share City Food Project was really established to try and look at new ways of making our food system more sustainable. We know that urban food sharing takes place around the globe, but we really don't know what social, environmental, and economic impact it has. The four phases of Share City include mapping, creating a database. This is the first international database conducted of all of the urban food sharing across 100 cities. And the second phase was looking at in-depth ethnographies, so working with food sharing initiatives all around the globe. Then we worked with those initiatives to co-design a sustainability impact assessment tool called Share It. And the final phase of Share City is examining the future of urban food sharing. So the Share City project had a multifaceted social and online media strategy. And this was important because as the food sharing initiatives are often invisible, we really needed to know from the grassroots what was going on. And so we crowdsourced our database of 100 cities looking for food sharing initiatives. We were able to work with sharing networks internationally to be able to establish the landscape really of urban food sharing. Yeah, so I think the first thing I would say to applicants is to really build in time to do communications and take it seriously, but also enjoy the ride. You will experience things you've never experienced before, but this will bring untold benefits to research. Another thing to remember is that to make mistakes, you're learning things which are not necessarily in your professional toolbox, but I've certainly learned a lot by working with media professionals, both online and social.
A really great video from Anna there. And, you know, it's a total no-brainer. Currently, Anna, one-third of all food produced around the world just goes to waste. So why not share it around? So that's brilliant. One thing I heard you mention there in the video, which I thought was really important, was be prepared to make mistakes. And that's something I think that is a really, really important lesson for anyone, and especially for our students listening, that, you know, when making decisions and figuring out what it is that you want to do, you will make mistakes. We all make mistakes every single day. Scientists are by no means perfect. So I think a really, really important message to put forward there, Anna. So thank you very much. Next up then, I'd like to introduce Ciara Farmer. So Ciara Farmer is a structural engineer with Cronin and Sutton Consulting Engineers, and is also a member of Engineers Ireland's Women in Engineering. Ciara is working as a structural engineer on a variety of exciting residential and commercial projects, including Fibonacci Square, which sounds very, very fancy if you ask me. She enjoys the problem-solving aspect of her job and contributing to shaping the built environment. Ciara enjoys contributing to making women in engineering roles more visible to schoolgirls so that they can realize the potential for their own future careers. Ciara, very, very excited, delighted to have you on board. How are you today?
Hi, Ali. Thanks for that. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you.
Amazing. So, Ciara, do you want to tell us maybe a little bit about some of the different buildings and different projects that you've worked on in the past?
Yeah. So I suppose one of the first buildings that I worked on early on in my career was 15 Barrow Street. It's now called the Bottleworks Building, and it's opposite Boland's Mills in Dublin. So that was a shared office space that we constructed on a very small site. Because it's surrounded by residential buildings, a lot of old cottages, we could only go up to three stories. So the solution then to get a bit more space was to construct a double level basement below that. But of course, the architect wanted to get some natural light down there. So there was chunks taken out of our structure to try and get the light down through these sunken courtyards. But it was a really great project to start off on, because although it was quite small, it had a lot of the tricky details and challenges that you would get with a big project. Since working on that, I've worked on some residential and other commercial buildings, and that all kind of led up to Fibonacci Square, which you mentioned there, which is kind of the main project that I've worked on for probably the last three and a half years, so quite a long time. And that's going to be the new Facebook European headquarters here in Dublin. So that's an office building with gym, with a car park, and with a lot of nice landscaped areas around it.
Brilliant, cool. And Ciara, I think it's really important that we actually get to see some of these things that you've been working on. So again, we have a video here just to show that talks a little bit about what you do day to day and shows us that building, which does look very, very cool. So we'll take a look at that video next.
Hello, my name's Ciara and I'm a structural engineer at CS Consulting in Dublin. My job involves working alongside a design team of architects, civil engineers, mechanical and electrical engineers, fire consultants and landscape architects to design buildings. Most of the projects that I've worked on have been residential and commercial, so houses, apartments, office and retail buildings. Most of my time is spent in the office working on structural designs and attending meetings to collaborate with the design team members. But I also visit building sites to carry out inspections of what's been constructed and make sure that it's in accordance with my design drawings. In simple terms, my job involves reviewing the architectural design intent for a building and making it stand up. I look at all the main structural elements, for example, walls, columns, beams, slabs, foundations, and review where they should be located and what size they should be based on the loading and the weight that they need to carry. I also have to review what materials to use, for example, concrete, steel, or timber. And this will usually come down to what will achieve the most efficient structural solution, achieve the architectural intent and vision, and what is best suited to the site conditions and constraints. So how did I get here? My undergraduate and my master's degree are in structural engineering with architecture from UCD. I chose this as I wanted something that would incorporate the problem solving side of science and math subjects, but also have room for creativity, because as well as science, I loved art at school. The course's main focus is to give you the fundamentals of an engineering degree with an appreciation for architecture. This gave me a good foundation as I moved on to start my career in an engineering consultancy. I've worked in CS Consulting for about 6 years now, and one of the main projects I've been working on over the last few years is Fibonacci Square. This is the redevelopment of the AIB Bank Centre site in Dublin 4 to be Facebook's new European HQ campus. The project consists of two six-storey office buildings connected by a 30-metre link bridge over a landscaped central podium. There are three levels below ground, housing a car park, a gym, back of house areas and plant rooms. I recently gave some of my colleagues a tour of the building as it nears completion, and the feedback, particularly from the younger engineers in the office, was great. It is exciting to see our designs go from a set of drawings and plans to a finished structure. One of the main challenges facing structural engineers at present is reducing embodied carbon. The building industry produces 50% of the globe's greenhouse gas emissions. A building's structure accounts for approximately 50% of its total embodied carbon. So we are key players in working towards carbon neutrality. We are making progress as an industry, but it is a challenge, and I'm currently on that learning curve along with my colleagues. As a career, engineering is never boring, as there is always something to learn or overcome, and I would highly recommend it as a dynamic career choice. I've recently joined the Engineers Ireland Women in Engineering Committee, and I'm hoping that some of the work that we are doing will make us more visible to you and convince you that this is a career path that can lead to great opportunities working on projects that shape the built environment around us. It's also a fantastic opportunity to meet like-minded people and to be part of a multidisciplined and supportive team. It's not all work though. Every year we take part in the Dragnet the Docks Dragon Boat Race at Grand Canal Dock, competing against other companies who work in the construction and property sector to raise much needed money for the Simon community. Here we are back in September getting ready to compete in a race. I hope this has given you a bit of an insight into the day-to-day as a structural engineer, and that you might think more about the possibilities and the opportunities that are open to you in a career like this.
That was amazing. So thank you very much for that, Ciara. I think, again, a couple of things that really stood out to me in the video was you mentioned your love of art. So again, just showing that whatever it is that you're interested in, there's a career in STEM that can link into that for me. You know, leave your other passions aside just because you want to get a job in STEM, for example. And also really interesting, the amount of carbon that comes from the engineering construction industry. So I think, again, highlighting that any aspect of a career in STEM is going to have to focus on sustainability a little bit and make some changes to, you know, support our planet for the future. So it's amazing. Thank you so much, Ciara. Finally, I'd like to introduce Dr. Jessamyn Fairfield, who our keen RTE viewers among us may have seen on Future Island over the past couple of days. Dr. Jessamyn Fairfield is a lecturer in natural sciences at the University of Galway. She leads research in nanomaterials, physics education, and public engagement with science. That's a bit of a mouthful. Jessamyn is also an award-winning science communicator and the director of MC of Bright Club Ireland, which is a research comedy variety night, which has held over 100 live shows across Ireland since 2015. Jessamyn, you're very, very welcome on board, and thank you for completing our panel here today. How are you? Lost
Jessamyn. Hi, sorry, can you hear me now? It froze just as you were introducing me and I was like, oh no.
Typical, you know, these things always happen. How are you keeping? How's the going for you?
Oh, it's going well, thanks. It's busy, but it's lots of fun stuff on this week, which is great.
Good. And physics is kind of your background a little bit. Have you got a favorite physics fact by any chance?
I mean, in general, my favorite thing about physics is how when you get down to the really small scale, the laws of physics are totally different. I think it's kind of crazy that we spend a lot of time learning physics and learning, you know, the nuts and bolts of the world around us. And then it's like, oh, when you get down to the atomic scale, let's go back to the beginning and kind of start over. I think that's part of why I ended up researching nanomaterials like Eilish.
So they just kind of go against everything that you expect them to do. They're kind of rebels, kind of rule breakers. Don't do
yeah, it's very counterintuitive. It's almost like science fiction underneath the world that we live in.
Cool. And that's actually what I've seen you doing on Future Island over the past couple of days, is taking a look at science fiction movies and seeing, is it fact or is it fiction? Is it actually possible? Which is a brilliant way to engage with STEM. And again, I think we have a short video to show here, Jessamyn, of some of the work that you do. So again, we'll let the work speak for itself.
Everything is different when it's small. Even what we think of as fixed laws of nature change forms at the nanoscale. And it's amazing that our intuitive understanding of the permanence of objects or the way that two objects interact is wrong for things as small as an atom. A single atom has different properties than an object made from trillions of atoms. That's because there are a discrete number of available states for the atom, so its energy and momentum are quantized, meaning that only some interactions between atoms are allowed by the laws of nature. This is the basis of all chemistry. But even though the light and energy and matter around us are all quantized particles, each of those particles is also a wave. We think of waves as something that happen en masse, like in water or air or a crowd of people. But while light travels in a straight line, it can also bend around corners, or build on itself to make a pattern of ripples, the way a wave does. Even individual particles of light can interfere with themselves, somehow passing through two places at once. At a quantum level, the light exists in a combination of states until an external observer makes a measurement, and the light collapses into a single reality. And even then, the more precisely we know where a particle is in space, the less precisely we can tell its speed. There's always uncertainty. This isn't what happens with things that are closer to our size. The quantum world is totally different from the world we know, and we need special scientific tools to interact with it, yet it underlies everything. Even the idea of an object existing in a fixed position with exact properties is in some sense an illusion. It is only through our observation that the quantum possibilities coalesce into a single, absolute reality.
The teeny world is an odd world, basically.
Yeah, it's a weird place, but it's pretty interesting as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. So similar to what we saw with kind of the microscopy images, you know, we often only think about the big stuff. I think especially with physics, you know, people are thinking all the way up into, you know, astrophysics, thinking about big massive planets and everything. But the teeny stuff is just as unpredictable and just as cool as well. So guys, glad to have you all back with us again. We're going to kick off the Q&A portion of our panel discussion today. So again, I'd just like to remind, if anyone has any questions for any of our panelists, please feel free to pop them into the chat function on YouTube. I will get to as many of them as we possibly can. While we're waiting for a couple of questions to come in, we do have some questions from some students lined up and ready to go. So I'm going to start off with a question from Jenna, who's a student in Santa Maria College in Rathfarnham. So we'll see what Jenna has to say.
My name is Jenna and I'm from Santa Maria College. STEM has traditionally been a male-dominated industry, but women are being encouraged to join STEM. My question is, how are you making careers in these industries more accessible for women?
Okay, yes. Question from Jenna there being, you know, everyone keeps talking about how we need more women working in STEM, but what is actually being done to make that a reality? So, Eilish, I might ask this question to you, if you don't mind. How do you think careers in STEM are actually being made more accessible to women and to girls?
Yeah, it's kind of disappointing. Like, for the last 30 years, there's been lots of projects running to try and address this 25%, so 1 in 4 ratio of females to males in physics, 30 years of kind of interventions and different things, and we haven't shifted the dial. So we need to do this at a holistic level. We need to look at the whole society, the women and the other and the males, the organizations, the infrastructure, the culture for it. And you can see that right across the research and academia that we work on. One of the things I've been doing for the last 7 years now is I've been giving teachers, our pre-service primary and second level teachers from across now the 7 universities in Ireland, starting with DCU students, we got them placements in industry. They went out to industry and worked as internships, doing STEM roles, experiencing a job in STEM and what careers was. Talk about breaking down barriers and challenging stereotypes and everything else. But mostly what it gave them, like when these teachers go out, they're only there for 12 weeks, they're paid, they're not observing, they're working as part of a team, whatever the business is. They come back, their heads are high, they're knowledgeable, they feel like professionals. They have an understanding of greater life skills. Mostly they have an understanding of what it is to be resilient. And I heard from all the ladies today, what it is to be resilient. There's a lot of people out there that will knock you and say, yeah, that's not for you. So remember when they say not for you, you say, why not? Mm-hmm. And challenge that. And I think it's having that resilience to go back and talk to people who are actually working in the field, see what they're working at and make informed decisions. That's the most important things. So what we've done is given these teachers an opportunity to go in and do that. So when they go into the classrooms of Ireland, we've had 180 graduates so far. Can you imagine 180 schools have teachers who've worked in industry, bring that into how they design lessons and don't talk about assets and basis from a textbook, but talk about it. When I worked in company A, we did this, we used nanotechnology to do that. And that's what we really need. We need those stories to come into the classrooms and schools of Ireland. So our young people are not where we were in school. They're getting introduced to STEM from an early age when they say, yes, we can. It's the Nike. We can do it.
Just do it. Exactly. Yeah.
Just do it.
I think that's really, really important, you know, because having working in a field does give you those experiences, does give you those anecdotes that make it more real, make it more exciting, and really will appeal to our students. I think one thing that you touched on there, Eilish, which is really interesting, is obviously certain STEM subjects have more of a gender imbalance than others. You spoke about physics, for example. From a zoology perspective, when I graduated with my degree in zoology, our graduating class was predominantly female. So again, we're going to see that there's imbalance.
We don't want gender imbalance other ways. And actually, this is not just a gender issue. All of the companies now have a diversity and inclusion agenda. So it's to look at people and to have role models like what we're doing today. We're talking about experiences, kind of opening up the opportunities and just not making these closed decisions, right? We're making informed decisions. So I think having role models and from that, we've done the stats. I've come on as head of school now in physics and we've 4 academics, females and 16 males, which is a typical ratio. But in our undergraduate students for the last 15 years, we've had 40% of our physics undergraduates are female, way above that national norm of 25%. And it's because we have opportunities in physics and biomedical sciences, physics with data analytics, physics with astronomy, applied physics, looking at technologies. And I kind of say to the students, and I go out to open days and higher options and whatever else, I say, I don't know where you're going to end up with a degree in physics, but I know where you can start. Do a degree in physics anywhere across the country, and then you can take your next step from there.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's the thing. Like, a degree in STEM is just a really valuable thing.
Opening doors.
Exactly. Yeah, absolutely. Perfect. We're going to move on to our next question then, which comes from Alicia and Carolyn, who are students in Trinity Comprehensive here in Ballymun. So we'll see what questions Alicia and Carolyn had to ask.
My name is Alicia from Trinity Comprehensive, and I want to know, where's the coolest place you've been with your job?
Perfect.
My name is Carolyn, and I'm from Trinity Comprehensive, and I want to ask you what's your favourite animal.
Okay, so I might jump in there and take the favorite animal question as a zoologist, if you guys don't mind. Now, of course, as a zoologist, I do have to have a very obscure answer prepared. So my favorite animal has a very, very funny name, which we will not laugh at because they are creatures with feelings. My favorite animal is a nudibranch, which is a sea slug. They're found in the waters all around Ireland and in lots of other coastal waters. If you've never seen one before, Google them. They come in all these amazing different shapes, sizes, and colors. They look like teeny tiny little colorful aliens. They're really, really cool. And my favorite thing I've ever found about them is a Tumblr account which compares nudibranchs to David Bowie's outfits of the past. And they are iconically similar. It's amazing. So I think that's where all the inspiration may have come back. Oh, Jessamyn's saying she has a nudibranch sticker on her laptop as well. So we're like-minded people here. Now, as for Alicia's question on being with your job, I might direct that one at Ciara, if we don't mind. Ciara, would you like to tell us about the coolest place you've traveled or you've been to with your job?
Yeah, so I suppose most of my career I have spent in Dublin, but I have gotten to see some really cool things. So one of my favorite things is when we are constructing a new building, especially if it's 7 or 8 stories high. Once you get up to that roof level, you can see right out over Dublin, and you're one of the first people, I suppose, to get that view. And if it's a private office building, I suppose only the people that are using that office space will ever really get to see that. So that's one aspect that I love, and that's a cool thing to get to see that no one else really gets to. The other thing would be, we don't just work on new buildings. I suppose we do a lot of inspections of old buildings. So I've gotten throughout my career to go into a lot of really old buildings, especially around Dublin and Georgian buildings in Dublin. And that's something that, again, a lot of people don't really get to see the features in some of these buildings, especially if they're kind of private houses or offices. So it's really amazing to kind of be a part of the history of a really old building like that. So that would be my two main.
Yeah, we need to appreciate what we have around as well. Yeah. Teeny tiny things. Appreciate the amazing city that we might live in already. So taking a look at Dublin from above. I loved what you mentioned about looking at old buildings. Well, we at the Rediscovery Centre, you can see a picture. It's actually over here. Picture of it over here. We are based in the old boiler house in Ballymun, which was decommissioned when the flats were demolished, and the building itself was going to be demolished, but it got saved and turned into the space that we now work in. So really amazing to appreciate what existed there in the past, rather than just focusing on everything being super duper new and super, super modern, and, you know, appreciating the work that went into these things beforehand. So next up, we have a question from Alicia in Santa Maria College in Rathfarnham.
Hi, my name is Alicia. I'm from Santa Maria College. And my question is, what does it take to be successful as a woman in STEM?
Okay, so I think we've touched on this a little bit, but Anna, we might let you take the lead on this question, if you don't mind. What does it take to be successful as a woman working in a STEM career or a STEM industry?
Yeah, thanks. It's a really interesting and quite challenging question, I'd say. I'll give you 3 points for now. So the first one, I think, is that we know, the science shows, that women are no less capable than men in STEM subjects. So it's important to remember that the problem is not you. it's the system, it's the external kind of culture and process, which has been mentioned before. And the second point really is that you get to define what success looks like for you. There are many different ways to succeed. So you just need to know your goals, and satisfaction in the job that you do is really, really important. And then finally, thirdly, I'd say, and this has also just been mentioned, that STEM is hugely diverse. And I think increasingly we will need people who can cross boundaries, disciplinary boundaries, maybe between STEM and other subjects, art, social sciences, particularly in the world of sustainability. So basically, I'd just like to say there's a role for all of us to contribute to knowledge and a better society.
Brilliant. Yeah, I think really important point there. What is success, you know, and really setting your own goals in life and kind of reaching for them as opposed to what stereotypically might be seen as success, is there in terms of like promotions or wealth or anything like that, you know, setting your own goals and your own career targets. That's what's going to make you successful and kind of striving for your own things. That's really, really inspiring. Thank you so much, Anna. And we're actually going to jump back over to Jenna because she had so many amazing questions when I went to Santa Maria College the other day. That's a second question that she would like to ask.
My name is Jenna and I'm from Santa Maria College. There is a perception that you have to be extremely intelligent or a high achiever to work in STEM, which often puts people off. What would you say to a girl who is an average student and has an interest in wanting to work in the STEM industry? How would you encourage them to join the industry?
Okay, yeah, so I think a very, very poignant point there from Jenna that we do hear quite a lot. Everyone thinks that you've got to be super duper intelligent to work in STEM or to be a scientist. So Aileen, what would you say to a student who maybe isn't that much of an overachiever in school, isn't getting all H1s or whatever they call it this day, I don't know how the Leaving Cert works anymore, who's not necessarily getting up there and getting 625 points? What would you say to them, or what advice would you have for them?
Yeah, I think it's a really good question. And I think there's kind of two ways to answer. So looking at STEM in general, but also geology as my own background. So I think like it's really important to remember that not everyone does the same way in traditional exams. Like really a lot of the Leaving Cert is memory and like memorizing essays and things like that. And to be honest, it can be really challenging and it's not a reflection on ability or anything like that. And that's one of the really beautiful things about STEM, I think, is that once you get into STEM, it's a you can flourish with creativity. There's so many different avenues you can go with. And there's so many different opportunities you can get involved with. Like everyone here is involved with so many great and interesting projects that are probably not directly part of their main research project. And so it's a really cool opportunity because it's filled with people that just want to learn and engage and are curious. And I think it's really also important to remember that there's lots of research and people are a lot more aware of it now in terms of the impact of diversity on teams. So if you're looking at research in general in STEM, like diverse research teams of people from lots of different backgrounds, lots of different abilities do so much better and come up with way more innovative solutions and ideas than ones of the exact same person and like just multiple people from the exact same history, the exact same background. So it's really important that we remember that moving forward, because to be honest, like the systems, especially in Ireland, can be quite variable. And like even for my own college course, if I had done my Leaving Cert a year after, I wouldn't have gotten enough points to go into my course. And so it really, like, I think there's a lot of perceptions around it that can like scare people away, but they're really not as bad, because like everything you do once you go into something, you have to be learn new things and be trained up. So even applying for jobs that have years of experience required, you'll still get trained up to do it. So it doesn't necessarily mean you shouldn't do it or apply for it. And I guess in terms of geology specifically, there's so many different areas in geology and STEM in general. So like it really doesn't matter about your interest level or your ability, because there will be somewhere for you. Like people, like I think in geology, have this perception that it's a lot field work based and you go out into the middle of nowhere and it's really like physical labor. And there's quite a big perception that's male dominated and a lot of other kind of perceptions around it. But really geology is so diverse. You can be interlinked with so many different elements. Like I work with just about every of the other sciences, like physics and chemistry. And it's really important that we have specialists with the kind of multidisciplinary background. And like I even work with social scientists and get to be involved with a lot of different projects. So yeah, I think just for anyone who's not sure whether or not they're I guess academic background is enough for STEM. It absolutely is. So many people come from so many different non-traditional routes. I know so many people that are now lecturers and really well-established researchers that came in from completely different non-traditional routes, didn't do the like traditional like Leaving Cert exam, might have come in as a late student to relearn or to change kind of disciplines, and people that didn't do well in exams because exams are just a memory game, I think, a lot of them. Yeah, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think it's something that I know a lot of students worry about. And Aileen, like, I can totally, I feel the same way you did. The year I joined science, the course that I did, it went up 50 points on the year before. And I know so many people who missed out on their dream science course by 5 points. And any other year, you know, they would have gotten it, no problem. But it's really important to emphasize that there's other ways to get into it. You know, we can't, you know, we can't forget about the post-Leaving Cert courses that are out there. Or as you say, different avenues can get you there at the end of the day. So you're saying you work with people who work in social science. So whatever it is that you're interested in, it's also never too late to change your mind. And you'll learn things along the way. Like, who I am now is very different to who I was when I was in sixth year making choices on my CAO. And you learn these things along the way and you figure out exactly what it is that you want to do. And you make those choices and changes along the way. As I said, I wanted to be an accountant when I was 14. And here we are. So very, very different movements there. We're going to take it up now. So Rosa is asking, what are some jobs in STEM that currently don't exist, but that you think will exist in the next 5 to 10 years? Now, really, really interesting, something we've mentioned a little bit already, is that the world of STEM is very dynamic. It's changing all the time. We've mentioned with Ciara how kind of sustainability is coming in a little bit more into these different disciplines. Jessamyn, without going too science fiction on us, what kind of stuff do you think the future might hold?
Yeah, well, I think to me, you know, one of the things that got me into nanoscience is how weird it is. But my current lab research is focused on using nanoscience to make electronics. And I actually think that there's going to be some really interesting things happening there, because like the computers and phones and everything that we use are all based on a type of technology from silicon. But there's lots of researchers now looking at, you know, the brain as an electronic device and how we can make organic electronic devices that might have totally different operational principles. You'd be coding on them in a totally different way to traditional electronics. So I feel like if like organic device designer and coder is a thing that I can make exist, I think that's going to be a huge area in the coming years, but there, you know, you can't do a course in that yet.
Yeah, one day you'll make it happen. Yeah, you know, our brains, I always talk about how our brains are super duper powerful computers. Might as well take use of that and see what we can run with that. Amazing. Ellie from St. Mary's College would like to know, what got you interested in science in the first place? So for me personally, I had a really amazing biology teacher in Leaving Cert, and I looked at her and I thought, yeah, she's doing a really great job at teaching. That's something I'd really, really love to do. And I spoke to her and I said, you know, what did you do? And decided science is really good for me. In school, for me, my two favorite subjects were biology and Irish. And I wasn't sure if I wanted to go down the Irish point of view or go down the, I think just having people to inspire you is really important. Obviously, as you all just said, David Attenborough has been an incredible role model for me over the years. And we might check in then and see, maybe Aileen, do you want to step in there and say what made you interested in the world of science and STEM in the first place?
Yeah, cool. Thanks for the question. I think, as I mentioned at the start, I wasn't really someone who always knew they wanted to do science, and I changed my mind a lot. But in secondary school, I got to do physics, and actually I was really, really interested in physics and tempted to study that in college and things like that. And I was really lucky that our physics teacher in secondary school was really supportive and took us to lots of different workshops and things like that. Our geography teacher was also really amazing and got us really interested in earth sciences and processes. And that was the ultimate one that got my attention. But I think for me, because my journey wasn't really like I knew what I wanted to do, it was more when I got into college that I was like, okay, that's science. I like science, and in particular geology. So my background now is with economic geology. And so that's kind of linked in in with mining and supply of resources. And so there's a huge amount of like bad reputation, obviously, associated with mining around the world. There's a lot of environmental concerns. And really part of the reason why I love being involved with it is because geologists care about the planet and we care about how it works and we understand how it works. And just about every geologist I know is doing geology and economic geology to try improve responsibility and think about how we can get the sources we need for society in a more responsible way. And so it's really amazing being part of that solution to society and being involved with that kind of element. So that's the part that really captured my attention as I progressed into science, I guess.
Amazing. Perfect. Thank you. Thank you so much for that, Aileen. Okay, I'm going to bring in another question here from Rebecca and totally open it out to the floor. So Rebecca from St. Mary's College wants to know, how does your job improve things for people? And you want to jump in there and say what goes on in their world that improves the lives of people, either locally, nationally, internationally. What is your role in STEM doing to help people?
I can jump in there, Ali, if you like.
Yeah, perfect. Anna, if you want to pop in.
Yeah, so going back to the ShareCity project, we're looking at what contributions food sharing creates for society and the environment. So a sustainability impact assessment generates data, information, and knowledge about the impacts that are being created by different kinds of practices. So we co-designed with food sharing initiatives, with local authorities, with scientists, with other scientists and policymakers, a toolkit which would serve to provide information about where benefits are being created. And if we know where benefits are being created, we can create the supports that they need to sort of optimize their potential. So that's certainly a key element of the work that we're doing with that project.
Very cool. Yeah, thank you. I'll ask Eilish if you want to jump in there as well on that one. How does your job of people?
So fundamentally, I'm a super teacher. In that my day job involves teaching undergraduate, postgraduate physics students, and particularly pre-service physics teachers. And what I believe is to teach is to touch a life forever. So by me inspiring the next generation of teachers, next generation of physics graduates, they go on and take on the world. So that's all I'm doing on a daily basis, work with physics students, working with pre-service physics and in-service physics teachers. So the experiences of doing STEM in schools is much richer, much more meaningful, and therefore much more impactful in solving lives and improving lives and society. That's really what we're aiming for here.
So we're equipping the students and the physicists and the scientists of tomorrow to change the world and give them the tools that they need to do that. Yeah, look, education is something that I'm sure every single one of us is incredibly passionate about. And, you know, a few of us have mentioned now we had teachers that inspired us when we were in school. And we kind of showed that a good or base level knowledge or interest, that's what inspires people to pursue careers in STEM. So I think that's a really, really lovely point that by teaching somebody something, you're equipping them with the knowledge to save the world and to make the world a better
world. Pass it on.
Exactly. Yeah. So I might ask, we're going to do two final questions because the hour has absolutely flown by on us. So the question that's come through for us here is, what is the most fun thing about your job? Now, Jessamyn, I might have to pass this one on to you here because we mentioned science comedy earlier on, which I'm very, very intrigued by. So presumably that's a very, very fun part of your job.
It is. It's a great part of my job. So I run a science and research comedy night called Bright Club across Ireland. I've been doing that for the last 7 years. And basically we teach academics to do stand-up comedy about their work. You know, to public audiences, anyone can come along. We have a YouTube channel for Bright Club Ireland where you can watch videos of people doing comedy about their work. And like, for me, this is really important because, you know, sometimes people are put off from STEM feeling that it's very like distant or like that only a certain type of person can do it. Or that it's like that it's no fun. But it is extremely fun. And like, there's also just a lot of laughs to be had when, you know, you're working on an experiment late into the night and trying to figure out something new that has never been done before. And you're just like, oh my gosh, does anyone else know how this feels? And I think that comedy is a great way to tell people that, yes, there are lots of people who know how it feels. So you can check it out, Bright Club Ireland on YouTube or any of the socials.
That sounds amazing. Yeah, because I think, you know, I run science workshops with very small little kids and I get them all to close their eyes and I say, what does a scientist look like? And I still, without fail, get the lab coat, the crazy white hair. I got the typical Albert Einstein style answer. And then I say to them, right, open your eyes. Look at me. I'm a scientist. We really need to try and break down those barriers of scientists being people who only exclusively use really big words to explain the work that they're doing. So we want to make that work accessible to everyone. I think through comedy is a really incredible way to do that. And again, just to big up the work you're doing at the minute, Jessamyn, seeing what you're doing on Future Island on RTE, just taking science in movies, because we're all big fans of movies. We're watching movies left, right, and center. It's always interesting to know, is that actually possible? Can that be done? Is that a load of crap, basically? Or is it something that is actually physically possible, scientifically possible? Is it beyond the realms of engineering? What actually is it? Now, guys, unfortunately, we are really, really coming close to the end of our discussion today. But before I let you go, I have one last question I'd like to ask each and every single one of you. So I'm going to put you on the spot really, really quickly. If you had to give one piece of advice to either your younger self or to a young woman in pursuing either an education or a career in a STEM subject, what would it be? That one piece of advice. So I might go in the order I can see on my screen here. So Ciara, I might start with you, if that's all right, putting you on the spot. One piece of advice either to your younger self or to someone who would be in a similar position.
I think a piece of advice will be to find a mentor quite early on, someone that you can talk to that doesn't have to be in the field that you're studying in or working in. Someone that when those kind of feelings in, which for me it definitely did a career when I kind of left college, my job, should I be here? What am I doing here? Can I do this? All those questions that you can one, because they've definitely gone through it before and they can kind of help you get through that. To do with your ability, it's just, and sometimes, especially in your early career, that would be my piece.
Yeah, really important. And not to be afraid to ask for help and to ask questions, be curious about it. That's amazing. Thank you so much, Ciara. Jessamyn, I'll come to you next then. What is your
definitely?
I think my piece of advice would just be to not let anyone tell you that you have to leave your other interests behind. Right, like Ciara was talking about the overlap between art and science in terms of construction and engineering and architecture. And I think for me, you know, both in terms of my science with comedy, and I've done other science and performing arts things, like I did a science dance project earlier this summer. And, you know, I always had a very strong interest in the arts. And I worried for a while about whether or not I could still do that if I became a scientist or if I went into physics. And I'm actually delighted now to find that, yeah, like you can combine those interests, and it's strong to be at the interface between disciplines. You know, you don't just have to be or do one thing.
Yeah, amazing. So yeah, don't leave your own self behind, and you know, you can bring your own personality and your own way of doing things into the career. That's amazing. Thank you, Jessamyn. Aileen, I'll come to you next. So
cool, great. I guess in line with what Kieran and Jessamyn was saying, I really agree. The stepping outside of your own networks is really important. And I think right now we're in a world that's so much more interconnected and virtually based. So there's not real opportunity to go learn new things outside of your own comfort zone and really challenge yourself to step outside of what you know. And that also will apply to your entire career. It's like you might end up doing physics, but as I said, it's really important to step outside and learn other disciplines and work together, because that's how some of the best results come out. And I think that kind of feeds into just always keep your curiosity and like always try new things and stay enthusiastic, I think, is the one thing I hear a lot is really important with job interviews. And I guess just finally, know that just about no one knows what they're doing. Everyone is confused and lost, and they might give off a really confident appearance, but underneath they're probably doing exactly as Ciara mentioned about, just I have no idea what I'm doing here. So
we've got a lot of the swan analogy where you're super duper chill and relaxed on the surface, but down below you're doing this, you're going 90. Aileen, I'll come to you next.
Echoing what the others said, I think you're allowed to be curious. You're allowed to be ambitious, right? We don't know what jobs will be there in 10 years' time. We know what problems are coming up now and what changes we've had in the last few years. So I would say embrace things, take on things, do mini scientists, young scientists, Cypress projects in schools, share your stories, share your successes with others, bring people with you. We need to change the system from within and throughout. As Jessamyn said, my passion is coaching football, playing football, and I coach under 10 girls, and I see coaching teachers a very much a parallel universe for me. Yeah. So you bring your holistic self to whatever you're doing, and everything you do develops transversal skills that you can apply to a wide range of energies for a wide range of complex societal issues. And that's just going to change over the next 30 years while these are in their careers and we're long retired, ladies.
Yeah. Good fight and keep bringing your
interest. We want to make the future bright, don't we?
Amazing. I'm fine.
Yeah, thanks.
Exactly.
And
welcome to you.
So, yeah, no, just coming up the end, I'm just going to repeat what other people have said in some ways, but I would say be yourself. There is no one single type of STEM scientist. Have confidence in your abilities and follow your interests.
Amazing. Yeah, and I think my one piece of advice is don't give up. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't do anything because you are incredible. Every single one of us is incredible. So don't let anyone tell you that you can't do anything. Ladies, I want to thank you all so, so much for joining me on our panel today. I think we've had some really, really amazing chats. It's been amazing to see what you actually do in your day-to-day life, kind of bring down the mystery of what it is that being a woman in STEM is actually all about. So I want to thank all of my amazing panelists for joining. I'd like to thank everyone who viewed, who commented, the students who said, send in their pre-recorded video questions in advance. Thank you all so, so much for taking part. And a big thank you to Science Foundation Ireland for sponsoring this event as part of our STEM and sustainability project here at the Recovery Centre. I'd like to give a shout out that there are free secondary schools around Ireland as part of that project. So do check e/education for information on that. And it is 12:02. We better this. Please thank you all so, so much for taking part. It's been lovely all, and I'm looking forward to you again soon. Thanks to me, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.